in your hearts.
My voice just boomed like that.
We can't just keep coming in, rolling in, and always looking at a church as a gas station to get filled up. I'm getting a lot of feedback. Let me come down here. We can't just keep looking at church as a hospital that temporarily puts a band-aid on our boo-boos. The reason why we've had, if this is your first night here, welcome. We are so glad you're here. If this is not your first night, you know I don't play around. I go right to the point. We see results. And I'm going to tell you right now, a lot of times people will come in with their emotional landmines and they say, "Pastor, I want you to dance all around my landmines." Don't touch those landmines or there's going to be something that's going to go off. And I'll teach you a lesson. I won't come to church for a week, 2 weeks, and if you really keep messing, I won't come for a month. And if you keep on this series, I'll even start looking for another church and start hopping around. But here's the problem with that. You'll just hop to the next level of pain. You'll hop to the next level of torment. And the thing is, if a minister truly loves you, and we do, thank God for the Hills. If a minister truly loves you, they have an obligation not to back off of the Word of God for your sake. And most ministers, if they'll be honest, which I believe most of us in here that are ministers are, we've been where you've been. We know how to get out of where you've been. And I'm going to tell you something, it ain't a skin color. Amen, I'll say amen for you. It ain't a skin color. It ain't on the wrong side, or the south side, the north side, the way, it doesn't matter what side. It matters if God is on your side. It doesn't matter if there's a recession, a depression, an oppression. None of that matters. What matters is what you do with that. I was talking to a good friend of mine this morning on the phone, and I just said, I'm real concerned about leaders in the body of Christ today. I'm concerned because too many of us are wanting baby Christians to run our church called a seeker-friendly church. And instead, we want them to dance around all of our landmines and never address issues. You know, like for instance, if you're doing something wrong, it's wrong. We're not going to sit there and hammer you, but we will direct you. If we know something's wrong, we need to change that. I mean, my goodness, why are we coming to church? Go to the club if that's the case. Come on, get your groove on. Let me know how that works out for you. But too many times, we always end up back where? Back in church, because we know, man, that's the only time I ever really got some real help. That's when I know they really care. I know they didn't back off. I know they didn't back off of my problems and my issues, and they really wanted to help me and to serve me. Oh, I'm here to tell you tonight, we are going to another level on purpose. Even if I gotta drag you up to another level, we are going to another level on purpose. God has already made that other level on purpose available for us. He's waiting for us to do it. How many of you are still waiting on God? Well, before you answer that, 2,000 years ago, He said, it is what's finished, everything. So what are we waiting on? Anybody ever heard of a gentleman named Reinhard Bonnke? He gets like a million people in a week saved. I've had the opportunity of going out and being on several crusades with him and just seeing multitudes of people won to the Lord. You have to take some of that mid-range out of my mic, guys. It's getting a little bit too canny up here. But I want you to know that when I was in his house in Karlsruhe, Germany, right there, Frankfurt, Germany, actually. And I had a question. He looked at me and he says, "Do you have a question?" You better have a question, you know, with a man of God like that. And I said, "Can you explain to me waiting on God?" He said, "I'd be happy to." He said, "Here's the problem." He said, "In the Old Testament, that's when everybody was waiting on God." He said, "That is an old covenant reality, them waiting on God." He said, "But a New Testament reality is He's now waiting on us." You may not feel healed, but you really are right now. You may not feel rich, but you are right now. Well, then how come I'm still struggling? How come I'm still going through this stuff? We're trying to help you with that. You're still waiting on God to do something He's already done, and He's waiting on you to accept the fact He's already done it. Oh, come on now. Nobody came to fight. You came on a Friday night. Come on, this is not Friday night fights, right? All right, this is. You came on Friday night because you're beyond hungry. You're desperate. There are people here that came to worship God and already have got many of your answers. But I want us to do something. There's a message God has birthed in my heart from this morning on. Just been nonstop meditating. I'm going to give that, and I'm going to give it to you, and it's going to birth something in you. But I want your heart open. Some of us are still too focused on ourselves. Can I be real with you tonight? It's hard to be God-conscious when you're still so self-conscious. One of the hardest things to do, Sister Marilyn, is to come to church and not be focused on oneself. One of the hardest things to do is to come and focus on something besides yourself. Why do I come to church? Same reason I go to a store. I've got a need. Why do I go to church? Same place I go to get my gas. You know, I go to a gas station because I got a need. I need fuel. But listen, do you know most of us would come to church with great expectation and see great miracles, signs, and wonders on a consistent basis? The revival that you keep praying for to come, it's already here. So we've got to not pray that it comes. We pray, how do I operate and flow with what's already here? And so the thing is, come to church expecting. Come to church on fire. Come to church pushing your pastor to a whole nother pasture he hasn't even been in. Come to church expecting that when you leave this place, you're going on another level higher than the one you came in on, and looking, instead of to get a blessing, you're looking to be a blessing. Oh, come on. I know I can't get amens in the church, but that's all right. That's the time we live in. But I'm going to tell you, this is God talking to you right now. Your worship life after tonight, if it doesn't go to another level, you can't blame anybody else, because there's no excuse. Even I'm going to another level tonight. Just lift our hands one more time. Oh, we worship you. You got your songs ready to go, guys. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we thank you, Lord. We glorify you. We worship you tonight, Lord. We praise your holy name. Create in us, Lord, true worship. Create in us. Strong in the Lord and in the power of His might, operating in a greater confidence. We are more than conquerors right now in this life. We are victorious right now in this life. Once you realize the battle is not yours, you'll start worshiping God like you've never worshiped Him before. The battle is not mine, but it's God's.
Come on, let's sing it now. Come on, come on.
This week. And I'm glad he decided. I wouldn't know if he didn't give it. But how many of you can say already at least something is moving and shaking in your finances? And it's in a good, you are. Look at all those hands. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, if you can't lift your hand, at least, you know, by fact, do it by faith. You know, yeah, something's happening in my finances. It's a good thing. Glory to God. And we want to thank Sister Marilyn Hill and Dr. James Hill, the greatest pastor on the north side of any side. Come on now. I also want to thank that crazy, wild, awesome, anointed drummer. Man, that was good stuff. Praise the Lord. Well, let's break open manna together. Did you come expecting? Did you come excited about what God wants to say to us tonight? Listen, I'm going to tell you right now, if you're getting half as hungry as I'm getting hearing myself preach, then you're getting excited. Some people don't get that. It cracks me up where people want to call confidence pride, and then they want to call false humility humility. Do you realize that under the anointing, I'm listening to myself just as much as you're listening? And I like what a minister told me one time. He said, son, if it's good enough for them, it's good enough for you. So I'll tell you right now, I may even buy my own CD today. Come on. Any women in here, or any mothers in the house? Okay, all right. Did anybody give birth to their child by themselves? Isn't it funny how you can, but it's also good to have somebody help you with the birth of the thing? Come on now. And so, in essence, I'm going to help you give birth to the thing that you've been carrying for so long. Amen. Some of us are 29 years pregnant with things that God has wanted to give birth to in you. Come on, how many of y'all know that's a long time to carry something? Yeah, hallelujah. And I appreciate the one man that came. You look like the bus driver, you know what I mean? You drove all these women to this women's meeting tonight. Thank you. I'm just messing with you, man. All right, glory to God. Turn with me, if you would, to Acts 17, and if you would, get your place in Matthew 15. Hallelujah. Man, God is such a good God. I mean, just when He outdoes Himself and you get comfortable, He'll outdo Himself again just to mess with you. Hallelujah. Acts 17. And it says here in verse 21, for all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to bear some new thing. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, ye men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious. For as I passed by and behold your devotions, I found an altar. He's talking to folks that believe they know how to worship now. He said, I found an altar, and it says this, to the unknown God, whom therefore you ignorantly worship Him, declare I unto you. Now, that's pretty cold, and it's pretty bold. But the thing is, there's some truth there in a lot of church services. We superstitiously are worshiping God, trying to get Him to do something, instead of worshiping Him because it's already done. Woo, come on now. And we'll see here that ignorantly does not mean you're just a bonehead. It means there's a lack of knowledge, a lack of intimate communion, a lack of really knowing the one you're worshiping. And I'm here to tell you, I'm going to declare it boldly tonight, because I think your worship life will go to a whole other level, because I'm tired of simply going to nights that are dedicated only for worship and not ever seeing a full-blown change. Instead, I would rather see true worshipers that are living a lifestyle of worship, that when they do come on what's dedicated to a corporate worship night, the place explodes. Let me tell you a story here real quickly about a friend of mine. And this is a true story. He's a friend of mine. Two of these guys, one of them's pastoring, one was a healing tech at Rhema. And they were roommates at the time, and they were going to go out and just do some stuff. And you know what I mean by that. Just go out. They weren't going to do anything crazy. They were just going to go out. It was the weekend. And the Lord said, I want you guys to stay home and to worship me. So they get together. They start worshiping. It's about 7 o'clock at night. They lost track of time. They entered into God's presence, began to worship Him like that, you know, that there was no tomorrow. And the thing that is wild about this story is that the firefighters broke down the back door and the front door to come in and rescue these two guys. You're like, why? They were looking all around, confused, could not understand. Now, this is in our lifetime, okay? This is in our generation. They were saying that they could not understand. They were on their mics going, we know that this is the house. This is the house we saw the flames and the smoke coming from. Oh, you're not hearing me. I'm talking about a worship life that causes you to walk in a supernatural life. And so the firefighters got them confused. The firefighters have brought in confusion all around because they're trying to put out something that's not there like they thought. And they started doing an interview and they found out how the firefighters came to rush to the house because they were confused. They still didn't get it. They were like, they looked outside trying to find the house that was on fire. A neighbor had called and there was more than one. There was three different reports of this house being on fire. Please send fire trucks immediately. And they said, well, what's the address? Well, we only know the street, but you will not be able to miss the house because it's the only one on fire. And the firefighters rushed in and they said, this is how we knew it was your house because it was the one on smoke and on fire. They couldn't understand it. They got to pray with the firefighters before they left. I'm telling you, when you worship God, you're not just trying to get Him to do something. You're worshiping Him because He has already done something. That right there, that nugget will change your worship life more than anything else. I don't worship Him to get Him to do stuff. I worship Him because that's His nature. He wants to give. If He'll give His only begotten Son, come on. If He didn't give us anything but salvation and no benefits and no prosperity and no healing, just the fact that we don't have to die go to hell. Is that not enough right there to worship Him all the days of our lives? Woo. So we see here that Paul noticed that there were some services going on, but there was some ignorant worship. Can you say ignorant? Ignorant worship. All right. Now let's go over to Matthew 15. Hallelujah. The one that's been having stomach cramps, you're being healed right now. Thank you, Lord. No more. No more messed up bowels. No more messed up intestines. Thank you, Jesus. Be free of that. And to let you know, it just seems like lately, the last